Good evening, everyone. I'm happy to be here in Emma Banim in Los Angeles for the third time, actually. And tonight's topic is preparation for Matan Torah, the acceptance of the Torah. As you all know, we are already on the 26th day of the Omer, and altogether it's 49 days preparation for Passover to Shavuot, which is two of the three regalim. Passover is one of the festivals, the regalim. And also Shavuot is also one of the three regalim. And actually every holiday has a Chol HaMoed. Sukkot has Chol HaMoed. Passover has Chol HaMoed. But Shavuot doesn't have Chol HaMoed. So it's very interesting because the preparation from between Pesach to Shavuot, it's like a Chol HaMoed, because it's preparation for the most important day in the Jewish history, the day that we received the Torah from Hashem, became the chosen people, we became the nation that made a covenant with God. You know, all these things, this is people, sometimes people may take it for granted, but basically the most important thing is that we should never think things like this, that Hashem chose us from all the nation, and we think, no big deal, so we have the Torah, the Goyim have their own religion, we have our own religion, everyone has a religion, what's the big deal? No, it's a very big difference. The only nation who really stood around the mountain and heard the voice of God in public is the Jewish nation. The acceptance of Torah, the holiday of Shavuot, is not only just another holiday to sit and eat and drink wine and eat meat. No. It's to remember that this day we became the nation of God. This is a very important thing. We have in Sukkot, now we do Simchat Torah, we celebrate with the Torah, we dance with the Torah, but Shavuot is the moment that we receive the Torah and we turn into the nation of God. It's very interesting because it says, if HaKadosh Baruch Hu would bring us to Mount Sinai and would not give us the Torah, Dayenu. This is what we say. Bizarre. And everybody asks, what Dayenu means, it's good for us also. Also good for us. So the question is, how can it be good for us if we wouldn't get the Torah? 210 years was preparation for receiving the Torah, the slavery. Preparation to, you know, to receive the Torah. And then after 210 years, we came out of Mitzrayim with lots of fear. The Egyptians were chasing us. We finally made it. Hashem killed them. He drowned them. All these enemies wanted to return the Jews back to Egypt. And finally we came to the mountain. And then would say, you know what? You're not getting the Torah. And we say, Dayenu. It's good for us also. How can something like this happen? We say it in Haggadah of Pesach. The answer is, the nation of Israel never reached a level of unity like that moment. Everyone arrived with one heart. Am echad, belev echad. With one heart, everyone was united 100%. 100% around the Torah and Hashem with Moshe Rabbeinu like never before. No one was a handicap. No one was deaf anymore. No one was blind. Everyone heard the voice of God, even the deaf people, even the blind people. There was a moment that will probably will never return in history unless the Mashiach come, we'll see some other miracles. But besides Mashiach, there's no chance to see any miracles like this ever again in history. Not only that, every slave, every shifcha, every maid, I should say, every maid reached the level of Yechezkel the prophet. Yechezkel was one of the top tzaddikim, top nevi'im, prophets. One of the top one lived approximately 2,500 years ago in Iraq, Babel. So the question is, every woman, every maid that never learned Torah or anything like that, she already reached a level of prophecy just like Yechezkel the prophet. This is the level of the nation of Israel even before getting the Torah. After getting the Torah, you know the rest. We became a knowledgeable nation, everyone learns Torah, synagogues, everything like that. So basically, this is something that we got to this moment, we almost got the Torah, and Chazal say, Dayenu, just for the unity. Today, we have a very big problem with unity. The Jewish nation, unfortunately, not only the Jewish nation, the truth is no nation is united. No nation in the world is united. In every nation you have minorities that are against the majorities and majorities who torture the minorities and take away their rights. Look at the Middle East, the Arab countries, the Kurdish, this, in Turkey, in Iran, as you know, everyone fights with everyone. So it's really nothing that's specifically correct only to the Jewish nation, no. This is something that correct for every nation. But the question that I'm saying is, with the Jewish nation that God united us with the Torah, how is it possible that we have among us so many different groups of people who don't like each other? This group doesn't like the other one doesn't like, this is not connect with him, not connected. It's affecting our shiduchim, marriages, affecting our parties, affecting the synagogues, affecting yeshivot, affecting which children will get accepted to yeshivot and which one will not get accepted. So all these things that is happening, all of it, it's come from one reason. One is, what is it? Racism. People are in love with their own race, and they don't like different races. And if they come from different countries, so they're used to their language, their custom, their nationality, it's very difficult for them to connect with a different group. And because of that, there's a lot of politics, lots of arguments, and there's really no unity. There's no unity, there's a very serious problem. Let me give you an example. The Gemara say there used to be a very wicked king. His name was Ahav. Very wicked king. He did horrible things. But when he went to a war, he was always winning. Him and his soldier always winning the war. Since when wicked people win wars? Usually the righteous should win, no? Not the wicked. But here, he was winning. Why? Chazal said, why was he winning? Because in his generation, all the wicked people were united. They're united. Unity, even among wicked people, helps them to succeed in what they do. What is it like? You take one straw. You bend it in a second. Take two, you bend it. Take 100, it's already a big chunk. You put them together, it's very difficult to bend it. So each one by itself, or each five by themselves, they don't have the strength not to bend down. But when you put lots of them together, then you cannot move it. Unity gives strength. When the Goyim wanted to build the tower in Babylon, what was the idea? To go all the way up to heaven and fight with God. As stupid as it may sound, you have to understand that even today, nobody knows who God is. Even us, the Jews, that we know so much about God from the Torah, for those of us who learn the Torah and know his opinions, know what he thinks about certain things, we know how he likes certain things and how he doesn't like certain things. But when you ask a Jew to describe who God is, there's nothing to describe. You cannot describe an image. You cannot describe a color. You cannot describe anything. And if you try to describe him as letters, that's not a description. When someone writes your name, that's not who you are. If someone writes four letters on a piece of paper, by that you know how the person looks? No. To describe something, you have to say tall, short, blonde, black hair, blue eyes, brown eyes. You give some ideas for the people to know what to look for. Just by writing on a piece of paper a name, it's not a description. So writing the names of God, the way it appears in the Torah, doesn't tell us that much. How does he look? Does he have an image? That doesn't have an image? The answer, he doesn't have an image. That's why there's nothing to describe. So in those days, which was thousands of years ago, everyone was searching for God. Now you have to remember that there was no Torah yet. There was no Torah. Since there was no Torah, nobody knew what to look for, the Goyim. How would they know? Today, they read the Torah. They know what you can know, what you cannot know. But in those days, there was no Torah. So how did they know what to look for? So they wanted to look for God. They thought there is in the sky, there's probably is watching us from there. Let's make a big tower and we go and fight against him. So Hashem came and mixed their languages. He made different languages. All of a sudden, he interfered with the free choice. One person was speaking language A, doesn't know anymore language A, begin to speak language B. How is it possible? The question is, why Hashem just didn't kill them and that's it? What does he need to change their languages? Or leave them alone, the fools, let them build a tower 500 meters up. Let them get waste their money and time. They can build the tower as much as they want. Eventually they get tired. Leave them alone. What was the idea to change their languages and then punish them? Some of them turn into monkeys, some of them into demons. Why? What's all this whole idea? The idea is very simple. What's the idea? Hashem wanted to teach us how much unity works. They were very united. They all came. They walked like crazy. One helps the other, give bricks, passing the bricks, the hammers. They all have one target, to go and fight against God. Of course, there's nothing they can do against God. But to show us, to teach us, unity is something that works. Let me ruin their unity. Change their languages, they begin to hate each other. It's not like it was before. Same thing today. Every nationality think they are the best. You come to the Persians, you tell them, you want to marry this nationality? No, we only marry Persian. You come to the Syrian? No, he better be Syrian. You come to the Moroccan? He's Morocco? From where in Morocco? From my city? I want him. So everyone wants his own people. No, we know the family. Really, what does it have to do with marriage? Your son wants to marry a girl, tzaddika, so she's different. She's from a different country. You know, what is really should be the difference? After a few months, they get along, they get used to each other, you learn about their custom, they learn about yours, and everything works out. But the people, nobody wants to do it. So I tell you a story. In the time of Napoleon, you know, in the end, they had to fight against Russia. So on the way to Russia, he wanted to ask Rav Chaim Mivolozhin. Rav Chaim Mivolozhin was a very big Talmid Chacham, the student of the Gaon Mivilna. So they stopped by him to ask him, what's going to happen to us in the war against the Russian? Are we going to win or are we going to lose? So the rabbi told him, the Russian will rip you apart in his face. It will destroy you. So they say, how do you say such a thing? We won the entire world. Every battle we had, we won. Now we only have to finish with Russia and we're done. He said, but in Russia you'll be defeated. They'll kill you. The Russians will destroy you. So he said, why, Rabbi? So the rabbi gave him a story. He told him an analogy. Let me give you an analogy. Based on this analogy, I will tell you basically, you know, what's going to happen to you based on this story. So he told him like this. He told him there was a rich man who bought 6 very expensive horses, best horses, one after the other. And one day he was going, you know, in a big storm with his carriage. And while he's going, entering the swamp, he got stuck with the wheels in a very deep sand. The sand was very wet. The wheels got stuck. So he take his whip, he hit the horses. They all go wild, but they're not moving. They all go wild, but he's still stuck for 1 hour, 2 hours, raining. Then after a few minutes, he saw a poor person with a lousy carriage and 2 horses. And this person with 2 horses, and this person come, the carriage got stuck. The poor man took his whip. He hit one time on one of the horses. They all started to go wild, and they pulled him out of the swamp in 1 second. And this is very skinny, cheap horses, not like the fancy one, each $1 million, the other each one. So the rich man said, I have 6 horses. All of them are top of the line horses, the best one. And this poor man has 2 lousy horses, and he got them out, and I'm still stuck here? How can it be? So he said to him, you know why it happened to you? He says like this. You bought 6 horses, each one from a different place. One from Saudi Arabia, one from England, one from here, one from there. Every one of you got a horse from a different place. So when you hit the Iraqi horse, the Persian, the Moroccan, the Bukharian, they're all happy. You hit now 1 horse, everyone is happy, so they don't want to run. Now when you hit the second one, the other one says, you laugh at me? Now I'm happy you get hit. But the poor man, he bought two horses, he raised them together, they eat together, they like each other. When you hit the first one, the other one felt the pain. So they both started to run. It's like two twin brothers. So when you feel the pain of your friend, you don't need to get hit. Your friend got hit, you run. You understand? So he say, this is the difference between you and the Russians. Your soldiers are all hired. They come for money. They don't really care about France and you. They don't care about Napoleon Bonaparte. They care about you. They care about the money. So far it was easy condition, weak armies, so you won. But the Russians are guerrillas. They're not going to take, they're very patriotic. They're going to kill themselves for their country. And they're all united. They drink a lot of vodka, l'chaim, but they're not going to give up. They will basically give their life for the country. So this is what happened. So in the end, that's where he was defeated. The rabbi told him, and this is exactly what happened to them. You know, so unity, like I said, it's something very interesting. So preparing for receiving the Torah, if we would not get the Torah, just the level of unity that we reach was already worth it. This entire suffering, just for that moment, it was worth it. Now, one more thing. In these 49 days that we count the Omer, every day we go one step higher towards the moment that we're going to receive the Torah. What happened if a Jew forgot to count one day in the Omer? The Zohar says that he's having like a cut, a shortcut that cuts the preparation for accepting the Torah. Now, many people think, what do you mean you keep saying accepting Torah, accepting Torah, accepting Torah? The Torah was accepted already. Now it's a holiday, it's a memorial day. There's nothing to accept now. I keep saying, I'm referring to this holiday of Shavuot as a day of accepting the Torah. But everybody understands, we already accepted the Torah more than 3,300 years ago. So why am I keep saying accepting the Torah? The answer is that every year we are accepting the Torah again. Yes, we're not standing in Mount Sinai and listening to God as it was originally, but every Jew receives how much assistance he's going to have and blessing in his Torah life this year. Just like in Rosh Hashanah, your parnasa is decided, how much money you're going to make. When comes, basically, when the holiday of Shavuot comes, so in that moment, every person is, Hashem decides for him how much Torah and how much blessing in his learning is going to have this year, how much he's going to understand, and that's based on how he behaves through the Torah in the previous year. So when Shavuot comes, it's very important for a person to stay up all night. We stay up all night and we learn and we pray in the morning early, because in the time when Hashem told Moshe, prepare them in a third day, prepare them that we're going to accept the Torah, no man should touch his wife, everyone should go to the mikveh, purify themselves, make laundry to the clothes, come in a third day, in early in the morning, and come to accept the Torah. And what happened to them? They waited and waited and waited, and in the end they fell asleep. They fell asleep in the end. It happens to me sometimes. Sometimes I come home in New York, I drive home, by the time I get home it's 2:30, sometimes even 3. So I say to myself, in 2.5 hours it's already shachrit. What's the point of going to sleep and get up early, late? Let me force myself to stay up another 3-4 hours. I go, I pray, then I come, I sleep a few hours. Better than to sleep 2 hours, get up again. So what happened? So I say, okay, let me stay up. So I take a book, I begin to learn. Just 30 minutes before the prayer comes, I fall asleep on my stand there. By the time I get up, the kids make noise, they go to school. I have another minyan 8 o'clock. Why? Instead of 5:30, I ended up going in the end 8 o'clock. It would be better off to go sleep on a bed, normal sleep. So this is what happened to the nation of Israel. Waited. When they were supposed to get the Torah, everyone went to sleep in the end. So Hashem said, oh, I'm giving you the Torah and you go to sleep. From then on until today, 3,300 years, every male Jew all over the world staying up in Shavuot and learn Torah all night. Now you may ask, Shavuot have something unique about it. What is it? We eat dairy. Where did you ever see a holiday that we eat dairy? Did you ever see such thing? Every holiday we have to eat meat and wine. Meat and wine, it's a symbol of a holiday. In Yom Tov, eating meat is like putting tefillin. Did you know that or no? If you eat a piece of meat, even 1 ounce, if you don't like meat so much, you like it a little bit, you eat 1 ounce, it's already counts like eating meat. So a person eat meat and drink one glass of wine, it's already mitzvah from the Torah. V'samachta b'chagecha, Chazal say it means to eat meat and wine. Maybe today it's a little bit different because today even poor people eat meat. It's not the end of the world to reach a piece of meat. But in the old days it was very, very precious. So if a person wanted to eat meat, when could he eat meat? Only on holidays. Every once in a while, there's no refrigerator, so if you have leftover, it's go to the garbage. So what happened? So the people used to make the meat for special occasions. Some that could afford every Shabbos. Some who couldn't afford 3 holidays. That's it. What do you think? Meat like today, you come to the supermarket, meat from the shelf, 1, 2, 3. Have preservatives in a frozen, in a freezer. It was different life. So what happened now? Why are we eating Shavuot dairy? The reason is that when the nation of Israel were waiting to get the Torah, in the morning they started to hear a siren. So they hear a siren called shofar, and it's becoming stronger and stronger. And then they see fire on a mountain. The mountain is all full of fire. Not only the mountain is full of fire, also it's smoke, steam, everything. And a telephone ring also in Har Sinai, you know. Yeah. So, you know what it is? I always say in the lecture, somehow there's half of the audience are doctors. Everyone, they get a phone call, they have to run. Wow, God forbid somebody wouldn't say hello to them. Wait another 2 hours, you answer the phone. It's not the end of the world. Everyone is an emergency call. So anyway, so what happened is they all prepared meat for the Yom Tov. It's going to be a special occasion. So they slaughtered the cows, the sheep, all the meat was ready. They make food. All of a sudden, Moshe brought the Torah, and he told them, I'm very sorry. All the meat you prepared is all not kosher, because you kill the animals with regular knife. You need to know where to slaughter. You have to know to check the lung of the animal. There's rules now. Look, God gave me this book. And in the book, he taught me the law of slaughtering. And you have to put salt. You got to get rid of the liquid, the urine, the blood. So you cannot eat it. It's not kosher. So what did they have to do? They had to take thousands of cows, tons of food, and throw it to the garbage. And today, you go to the Arab, you say, hey, Muhammad, I have something for you. Here, see? This cow, it's not like kosher. Give me $1,000, take it. It's called halal meat. Muhammad, take it, puts it halal meat. The Jew did the job for me, because they need to slaughter. But they don't know all the oral laws. So they only know animals have to be slaughtered. But they don't know how to slaughter, with what, check the knife, check the lung. They don't have all these rules. It was slaughter, it's kosher for them. You understand? Because they don't have the main part of the Torah, which is the oral law. They only have the written law. So they only can know a little bit from what the law is by reading the written law. So they take everything, all the meat that is not glad kosher, you give it to them. So the question is now, what happened? They didn't have who to give it to. They're in the middle of the desert. Now all the food was a waste. So now, how many hours it takes to prepare new food according to the law? First, you have to learn the law. Nobody knows the law besides Moshe. Moshe cannot slaughter 5,000 cows now, or 10,000 cows for 3 million people. And also, even if everyone knew the law, let's say he taught them quickly the law, how to do, what to do, but from the minute you slaughter the cow until you take the skin off, until you cut it to pieces, you open it, you clean all the inside, until you put salt, and so 3 days. You cannot do it in 2 hours. It's a whole long process. What do you think? Take the legs off, the head off, clean. Ooh, you should see how much work there is. And take all the fat and the gidanashe. You got to take the ligament from the back of the cow. It's a complicated work. So there's no time. You got to start the Yom Tov now. It's a holiday. So all they had to do is they could take milk. That's it. They went, they took milk. And from the milk, they make omelets, cheesecake, whatever they were able to make. And that's why we eat dairy 3,300 years, because this is the only holiday that our parents ate dairy. However, don't make mistake. You still have to eat meat and wine. So what do we do on Shavuot? This is what we do. For those who stay up at night, you come in the morning after the davening. It's a Yom Tov, like regular Shabbat, davening with Musaf and everything. So let's say now, sunrise, It's around 6 o'clock in New York, so around the same few minutes here and there. Here in so you go to shul around 5:30, 5:15, let's say. After staying up all night, so it's a short night. You come to shul around 11:30. You stay until 5 in the morning. They start praying shachrit. By around 7:30, you finish. You come home. What do? You make kiddush with dairy, put bread, cheese. If you have some borekas, whatever you have in cheese, you eat dairy. If you make kiddush, let's say you go to sleep. Then later, 1, 2 o'clock in the afternoon, you come again, you make a motzi, you don't need another kiddush. You made kiddush already. You do a motzi, you eat meat and wine, and that's it. So it's like another meal, but you have, because in Yom Tov, you have to eat meat, and you have to eat wine. So that's really what we normally do. Some people, the ones who do not stay up for whatever reason, so they go to regular minyan, let's say 8:30 in the morning, they come home 11:30, so they do kiddush, they eat dairy, then they pick up the tablecloth, the plastic, they pick up everything, they take it away, they rinse their mouth, they brush their teeth, whatever, that there's no cheese stuck in the teeth, and they bring the meat. Meat you can eat right away after cheese. Don't have to wait even a minute. All you have to do is rinse your mouth. You rinse your mouth very good, you can eat meat right after. But cheese after meat, you have to wait 6 hours. This is the rule. One way or the other, both of them are kosher ways. So let's move on. Many people do not understand, unfortunately, the significance of receiving a Torah from Hashem. They don't understand. They're not really thinking in a right way. What does it mean to have in my house a book that was given to me by the Creator of the world? If people would appreciate that I have a book that was given to me, to my father, to my uncle, to all my friends, that was by the Creator of the world, and he told me that you have to learn every day in this book, everyone would appreciate it. 1% would not leave the book for a minute. Would not leave it. Well, he got such a treasure from the Creator of the world. You know what it is? Technically, there are many goyim in the world. Percentage-wise, there's not even 1%. But from 7 billion goyim, 1% is a lot. That admire the Jews, not because they have earrings and tattoos. They also have it. They don't need you to impress them with your earring. They admire the Jews because they read in their own Torah, Tanakh, they read in their Bible, that God loved the Jews and blessed them and gave them the Torah. So those goyim are clever sometimes more than the Jews. Because some of the Jews not only do not appreciate the Torah, disrespect the Torah on purpose. But some of these goyim, they are more clever than some of these Jews. Because they respect the Jews only for one reason. Not because he's a good person, he doesn't know him. Not because of anything, just for one reason. What is the reason? That God gave these people the book. And from them we know the rest. From them it came to us. That means they are very important. I always say to people, if you see a big Talmid Chacham, someone who knows a lot of Torah, rabbi that knows a lot of Torah, even if for whatever reason you have something personal against him, I don't know, he didn't respect you enough, he didn't agree to marry you, he didn't agree to something that you requested, you wanted to do a party in a shul, he did not agree, whatever the reason is, politics, we have plenty. Just the fact that Hashem saying the Torah, that he admires people who knows a lot of Torah, should make every one of us admire these people because God admired them. This is, what is it like? If you have a father, and someone loves your father and helps him very much in business, is it possible that you're going to hate this person? No. He loves your father, he helps your father, you love your father, so you love this person. You're my father friend, you're my friend. Fair, no? The other way around, if he's an enemy, enemy of your father, he beat up your father, embarrassed him, can you be his lover? Can you love the enemy of your father, someone who disrespects your father in public? No, right? It's not possible. So the answer is, if this person loves my father, I love him. If he hates my father, I hate him. Who said that in the Torah? King David, Tehilim. Mesanecha Hashem Esna. Mesanecha Hashem Esna. Right? David HaMelech say, everyone who hates you, God, automatically I hate him. And I'm going to fight against them. I'm not going to be afraid of them. Also he said, when I go, every king, I tell you something very interesting and a beautiful story in a second, but first let me tell you the Gemara. The Gemara said, David HaMelech said to Hashem, every king, He's sitting in his palace, people serving him, enjoy life. Look at me, what kind of king I am. What I do, I sit and women show me their clothes and I have to tell them if they're pure for the husband or not. Just like every rabbi that does it. You can't put it in a drawer, you get a phone call later, kasher. Phone call later, not kasher. You're allowed, you're not allowed, you have to go to the mikveh, you don't have to go. So I'm just an ordinary person. I serve the people in the worst job that a person wants to do. What man wants this job? You do it because there's nobody else to do it. There's very, very few people that knows how to do it. It's a complicated thing. And it's the most important mitzvah in the Torah of Nida. So this is mamash a situation of life and death for eternity for the souls. So someone who needs to know it, must do it. There's anyway shortage of people who knows how to do it. So I tell you some interesting story. One time, you know, I have a yeshiva in Yerushalayim, and there's more than 20 avrechim learns there. It's, if you ever go to Yerushalayim, it's in Makor Baruch, Alfandari. It's Alfandari, it's a small street. It's right next to Rabbi Batzri, the big Kabbalist yeshiva, mamash a minute walk from there. Near Yehov Yafo, Yafo Street. So over there, they see it, the name of the shul, it's Matalon. It's a legendary shul. Rabbi Alfandari, the legendary tzaddik that lived 120 full years and never stopped learning Torah, his original chair is still there in the shul from 100 years ago. The chair he was sitting all his life and learning on it. And on the wall, you see that this is a reserved place. Hashem help us that we got the place to learn Torah over there. Very interesting. We were in different place before, and Chacham Matalon passed away, and they needed somebody to take the place and watch it, and we took the job, and we now have a holy place to sit and learn Torah over there. So I have one supporter, one main supporter that most of the yeshiva he pays the expenses. One person, most of the yeshiva, a Persian Jew. One time, you know, every person who gives money, even though he likes to give and he sees results from his money. Every once in a while, there is evil inclination attacking him. What are you giving so much? What do you need to give to people who sit and learn all day? What good we get from that? You know how it is. It's a businessman. He's not a rabbi. So every once in a while, he has to give new checks. You know? So every time I have to call him, I pray to Hashem that the evil inclination didn't turn his head away. So the last time, I called him up. And he say, I tell you what, I'm thinking about it, if I should do it or not. I say to him, what happened again? Last year you thought about it, Baruch Hashem, you made up the right decision. Why you have to think again? So he says to me, tell me, what's tachles? What's going to be in the end? These people sit and learn and learn and learn and learn. They don't go to work. They're not doing anything. They're not bringing parnasa for their family. So what, they're going to stay there forever and learn all their life and someone would support them? That's the average question that everybody asks. Every wealthy person, when you ask him to give to the Torah, if he doesn't understand how much he's gaining by supporting Torah, he's going to ask a million questions. So I told him, what do you mean? Do you understand the level of learning Torah that you're asking me this question? He said, yeah, I understand that. They can learn Torah and they can walk at the same time. So I say to him, what's going to be in the end with them? They're going to be rabbis? They're going to give service to the community? I want to know what's going to come out of my investment. So I told him, you know what we learn in yeshiva right now? We learn Masechet Nida with poskim to halacha, and each one of them would be able to tell women by looking at the blood of the cloth if she's pure or not. And that's very rare to find because most people don't want to learn it. And there's not enough. So you know, it's difficult. Sometimes, you know, there's pressure. She has to wait. She wanted to go tonight to the mikveh, but there's no answer until tomorrow or the next day. It's affecting things. So the Jewish nation needs people like this. And this is what they learn. And they're all going to pass the test and get a certificate that they are able to inform women if they're pure or not. So I didn't convince him. He thought to himself, pure, not pure. This guy's selling me stories. So the next morning, he went to shiur after Shachrit. Daf Yomi, they learn, and the rabbi opened the Gemara, and he say, David HaMelech say, listen good. David HaMelech say, Ribono Shel Olam, every king is going to celebrate, enjoy life, and I have to check tablecloth. There's no one to do it. I'm busy with this, because you know how important it is for you. Called me up, all excited. He said, I got my answer from Hashem. Tell them the check is on the way. You know what it is? So Hashgacha of Hashem is amazing. How it works is amazing. So this is the story, by the way. So many people do not understand and do not appreciate the Torah. If they appreciate the Torah, they'll never give up. The Gemara said there was a rabbi, his name was Rabbi Kahana. And he has a son named Salik. When the son was 5 years old, he wanted to send him away to yeshiva. Now remember, in the old days, there was no transportation like today. You get on a train, you get on a bus, and you get there, or you get on a plane. Yeshiva is far away. Even if it's 10 miles away, you don't come every night. You come once a year, or maybe once every few years. It's very far. Well, you're going to come on a donkey, you're a little boy. How are you going to come? There's no buses, and it's dangerous. There's robbers on the street, all kinds of dangers. You go to yeshiva, it's until you mature. That's how it was. You don't see your son. He goes one day. Next time you see him, when he has beard already, you don't recognize him. So what happened? So let me tell you what happened. This boy, Salik, his father, Rav Kahana, wanted to send him to yeshiva far away. So after that, the wife did not agree that he will go to yeshiva far away. Maybe we're going to need more chairs. So thank you, Shaul. So he's... His mother did not agree that he will go to yeshiva far away. So he said to the wife, what do you care about your own egoistic reasons? Let our son go and become a big Talmid Chacham, a holy Jew. And she said, I don't care, he can learn in town. He said, but in town there's no level like the level that he needs. We have to send him away. It's good for him to go to the highest level. She said, I don't care, let him learn in lower level, as long as he's by me every day, I see him. So he went to the rabbi. Now they have big arguments already. Soon they're going to get divorced because of this. Big arguments. So the rabbi said to her, tell me, if you want the boy to stay home, are you committing yourself to cook for him and his tutor, if your husband will get him a private tutor to teach him at home? You're going to take care of all their needs, all the food that they need every day to feed them, that they sit and learn all day, every day? She said, of course, I'll make them the food and the boy will be here. And I can see him every night. So the rabbi said, okay, that's what we're going to do. Get him a tutor, I'll teach him, pay him, finished. How many years they learned? How many years?
10, 20.
Now they went into the room from morning to night, all year. How many years? No, guess. 3 months? No? 25 years. Psh, kol hakavod. 25 years. 25 years they learned. So he became 30 years old. After he became 30 years old, the father, the tutor, the rabbi, came to his father and said, Rav Kahana, your son knows the Torah just like you and me, or even better. There's nothing I can teach him anymore. He knows everything. We went all over everything. He's a brilliant boy. In 25 years, he finished the Torah. So it's no point of me charging you. I feel I'm stealing your money. He doesn't need me anymore. He can tutor anyone else. So the boy finally knows the entire Torah. He decided finally to take a walk on the street. So he decided to go to the market. He goes to the market. He never been in a market. He was 5 years old when he started to learn Torah. So he goes to the market. He see people sell vegetables, fruit, and one guy sell lemonades. Squeeze lemon with water, with sugar. Lemonades, 5 shekel. So he come to him. He said, would you give me a glass of lemonade for free? So the owner of the lemonade booth, he said, for free? Why, I don't know you. He said, oh, yeah, you know, but I just came out of a room. I learned Torah for 25 years. I really don't have money. First day, I'm out of my learning. So he said to him, good for you. What do you want from me? This is what the fool told him. It's good for you, but what do you want from me? Why should I give you lemonade for free? Go bring 5 shekels. I'll give you lemonade for free. So the boy, it's not a boy anymore, 30 years old. He got upset so much. He went home, threw his jacket and his hat on the floor. He was very upset. He went to the room. The husband comes home, Rav Kahana. His wife said, don't ask. Look what happened to him. So Rav Kahana waited until he relaxed. And then he said to him, come, son, I need you to do me a favor. I give you this diamond. This is very precious diamond. I'm going to send you to this market and I want you to write how much every business owner offer for the diamond. You go over all the people in the market and tell me which one gave the best offer because I want to sell this diamond. So he went to the first one, he said $300. He went to the second one, $500. The other one, $250, $700, $900, $100. Everyone gives a very low price for the diamond. By the end, after he went all day in the market, the best offer, $2,000. He comes back to his father. His father looked at the list. He started to smile. He said, don't worry. Now tomorrow I need you one more favor. I'm going to send you to a different market tomorrow. I want you to go over all the booths over there and write the best offer and come back. Son is a good boy. He listens to his father. He went to a different market. He comes to the first booth. They look at that. So I give you $1 million for it. $1 million, he say? Yeah, $1 million. That's my best offer. So he write it down. Can't believe how $1 million, 2,000, $1 million. What's going on here? He went to the next one. How much he gave you? $1 million? I give you $1.2 million. He write it down. Keeps going. $7 million, $8 million, $10 million already one guy offered. So he comes home, say to his father, I didn't know we're such rich people. So the father said, what did you notice between yesterday's market to today's market? Said, yesterday everyone gave me peanuts. And today everyone gave me millions for the same diamond. So how can it be? He told him, this is the difference between an ignorant Jew to a Talmid Chacham. Someone who appreciates and knows the value of the Torah will give you eternity for it. Hashem knows the value of the Torah. That's why we get a huge reward for learning. When you went to the market of the fools, what do they know besides making lemonades and cut watermelon? They know the value of a diamond. They're not in a diamond district. They don't know how to evaluate a pink 10-carat diamond. That's why they offer you 1,000, 5,000, 2,000. They didn't know what it's worth. But when you went to the market, 47th Street, with all the top Bukharians and Persians sitting all day looking at diamonds, they know very well what's going on over there, no? So they knew this. If they offer you 10, believe me, it's worth 30. Yeah. They're not so generous to give money away. You know, it's business is business. They want to make money. And this is what happened in the end. So he said to him, don't worry. The Torah you learn, Hashem knows to evaluate it. Don't worry about the lemonade guy, the fool, instead of run after you and say, take my entire lemonade, come every day for free for the rest of your life. I know one dentist in New York. About 10 years ago, I asked him, if he can take care of the guys from the yeshiva for free, because they cannot afford. They come, they don't have money, they have root canals, feelings, all kinds of problems. Would you take care of the guys from the yeshiva? He didn't take him a second to agree. Of course, anytime. 10 years, hundreds of times people went to him over the years. Every week, one or two or three, they go in together in groups. They go to him. A doctor, I have pain. So he check, x-ray, he has feeling to do. Feeling, let's say $100, right? He say, he doesn't do just feelings. He does cleaning, he does sealing, he does more x-rays. He does everything. I need to do feeling. He does everything for him. Root canal with the best crown. Why? He evaluates people who sit and learn Torah. And when you thank him too much, you get embarrassed. Say, ah. Persian doctor. No, you're thanking me so much. Well, of course. Takes care of all the people for many years. Why is it? He appreciates the Torah. Appreciate people who sit and learn Torah. Not only he doesn't complain, why don't you go to the army? Why don't you go to work? All this nonsense. They don't know that people who learn Torah save the Jewish nation from who knows how many tragedies. People who don't understand the value of the Torah, they think people who sit and learn Torah, it's like in a library. You know, in a library, sitting on their laptop and read a little bit some articles from college. They don't understand that every second that a person learns Torah is the highest level in the creation. They learn the book of God. There's a direct connection with God. It protects us from tragedies, from wars, from problems, from bombs, from terrorism, for all kinds of things. The problem is that there's not enough people who learn Torah. This generation, many people learn Torah compared to previous generation, but still not enough. How many people learn? Most of the Jews are busy with work, even the religious Jews. They don't have time to come to learn. Maybe on Shabbat, 15 minutes between Mincha and Arvit, they hear a little Pirkei Avot. This is basically the whole Torah they learn all week. Why? They're busy. And they don't understand that the most important thing is the Torah. This is what David HaMelech say. Tov li Torat picha me'alfei zahav v'chesef. Your Torah is greater for me than all the money and the wealth in the world. All the gold, everything. And he really lived according to this say. He didn't care. Palace, soldiers, bodyguards, all these things that a king has. Only wanted to do. Oh, what does David HaMelech say? Shivti bevet Hashem kol yemei chayai. I wish I will have the merit to sit in the house of God my entire life. Lachazot benoam Hashem ulevaker beechalo. To see the beauty of God and to visit his home. So something is not right here. First he say, I wish I will have the merit to sit in the house of God. And then he say that I should see his beauty. It's glorious. And I will have the merit to visit in his house. Before he say, I hope that I'm going to sit all my life in the house of God. That I should see his beauty. And then he say, and to feel like I'm visiting. Levaker bechalo, and to visit the house of God. So the answer is, many people get used to the place. So they don't appreciate anymore what they do. I want to be in my entire life in the yeshiva. And feel every day like I'm the first day visitor. That the excitement will never go away. Why? Because when a person is excited from what he does it best. When he gets used to it, I don't have to tell you what's going on. You know, when David HaMelech wanted Hashem to tell him the time of his death, he said, tell me about my years. When will they end? So he told him, you know that I'm not telling any human being the time of his death because I don't want to eliminate his free choice. So David HaMelech said, okay, tell me at least what day of the week it would be. So he said, it will be on Shabbat. So he said to him, Hashem, why on Shabbat people will have to worry about my body, cannot move me, I'll be mukzeh. Let me live until Sunday. Well, what's the big deal? Give me another few hours. I have to die on Shabbat. So he told him, I'm very sorry. There's already a plan that your son Solomon, Shlomo, is already going to be the king from Sunday already. And one king cannot interfere with the other king. You have to pass away from the world that the kingdom goes to him already. So he said, okay, in that case, make me die on Friday. Take a day from my life. I'd rather die on Friday than die the next day on Shabbat. So he told him, 1,000 sacrifices that your son Shlomo is going to sacrifice for me in a holy temple in Beit HaMikdash, one day that you sit and learn Torah is greater for me than 1,000 sacrifices that your son will do every day. And you want me to take you away a day before your life? Do you understand how much a day that you learn Torah is mean to me? It'll show you the value of the Torah of a holy person. And if you didn't know, when they opened the Beit HaMikdash, the first one, King Solomon made a big party. And they brought a lot of sacrifice. Who knows how many goats and cows they brought to the first day of Beit HaMikdash when they opened it? Chanukat HaBayit. How many? 22,000 parim. 22,000 cows. And how many goats? 120,000 sheep. Each goat, sheep, it's about $300 today if you go to buy it. So it's $36 million. 22,000 cows. Each cow is about $5,000 today. Big cow, full of meat. Yeah, you buy it for five, you butcher it, you sell it for 15. Steaks, these, ribs, every little piece, $10, $15. Big business. So 5,000 each today, so it's $110 million. So together, $146 million in one day of sacrifices all over Israel. And Hashem say to him, the day you learn in the Torah, worth it for me than anything your son was going to sacrifice for me in a holy temple. And if the people would only know the value of the Torah, they'll go crazy for it. They'll do everything for that. Sometimes people leave the Torah for such nonsense. You can't believe it. Yes, his cousin has a birthday party. Who cares about your cousin's birthday party? It's going to bring you to heaven with the cake that they serve. You're leaving the 2 hours learning that you have Torah or a lecture that you had tonight or for a stupid basketball game. If you're so addicted to it, record it and watch it when you come back. Better not to watch it, to waste time on it. But if you're so addicted to it, how can you let it affect the Torah? You know, there was one rabbi in Bnei Brak, is teaching every night from 8 to 9 a Shiur Gemara in Bnei Brak, in a shul. A group of business people come after work, they sit for 1 hour and learn the day, the page of the day. Today he told them, tomorrow my daughter gets married, so I won't be able to come. I want everyone to go over what we learned. Do a repeat. So they told him, no problem, Rabbi, tomorrow we'll manage without you. Mazal tov. He said, I didn't invite any one of you because I don't want you to lose the 2 hours learning. And I know you'll be embarrassed for me. You come to the wedding. It's better you sit and learn Torah than come and dance and drink a little l'chaim. It's better. Say, okay, we agree, no problem. What happened? The next day they all set to go repeat. 8:05, he walked in. Eh, what happened? Didn't your daughter's not getting married tonight? Yeah, she is. So what are you doing here? He said, I'll tell you what I'm doing here. The wedding is 6 blocks away from here. I saw the rabbi didn't show up yet. Now until he comes, until they prepare the ketubah, until all these pictures, this, that, until they walk my daughter to the chuppah, it's at least an hour. So I figured that I have an opportunity not to ruin the shiur. So he, quick, let me use his black tie. He ran to the shul to teach in the night of his daughter's wedding. You understand when a person loves Torah, you understand it? He doesn't give it up for anything in the world. Now, you know, there's a big darshan, it's called Rabbi Yaakov Galinsky. One time I was with him on a plane, an airport on a plane. He's a very short man, and a very high in Torah and in holiness. So Rabbi Yaakov Galinsky one time asked a question. What was the question? He said, "Ki ata teshalem la'adam kema'aseu." The Torah say, Hashem pays every person according to his actions. So he asked, what's new here? What's new about it? Of course, Hashem pays everyone what they deserve. He already said in the Torah, to the righteous people, to the wicked people, reward, punishment, everyone in the end gets what they deserve. What's the news here that David HaMelech has to write, Va'ata teshalem la'adam kema'aseu? You are paying everyone according to what he does. There has to be something special about this. So he says, every person gets different reward for the same mitzvot. Two people learn Torah. Reuven and Shimon learn Torah. 1 hour every day, together. Together, word by word, they hear, they listen together to each other, they learn, and they go up to heaven one day. Is it possible that they're going to get a different reward, one from another, for the Torah that they learn? The answer is not only that it's possible, for sure it's going to be like this. No two Jews will receive the same reward for the same mitzvah they did. Why? First question is, where you came from? Where you grew up? You grew up in a place of Torah or you grew up in a kibbutz? If you grew up in a kibbutz and you made it to what you are, every mitzvah you do is a much bigger reward and definitely learning Torah. So right there, right away, every mitzvah you do, it's much better than someone who born religious. Makom shebaalei tshuva omdim, afilu tzadikim gmurim enam omdim. Someone who's Baal Tshuva is much greater than someone who's born religious. Someone who's born religious just doesn't know any other way. Yeah, he has his desires and even inclination. Everyone has it. But he doesn't know the dirty world out there. He's not aware of it. Plus, he doesn't have desire to become a Chalel Shabbat. All his entire life, everyone he knows is Shomer Shabbos. He's been growing up like this. But someone who came from the dirt and became clean and gave up all these infatuations and illusions and desires, etc., that's a much greater sacrifice. So what's happening here? So first thing, where you came from. Second thing, how difficult it is for you to learn. Some people learn right now, they enjoy very much. They focus, they remember, they understand everything, they have a sharp brain. The other one suffers. His brain is not so sharp. He has problems in business, in marriage, with children. His mind is somewhere else. But he still doesn't give up and come to the shiur, and he learns with much more agony and pain. The one who sacrifices and learns with pain gets a much bigger reward than the one who learns without pain. It's obvious. According to the sorrow, that's how much the reward is going to be. There's one more reason. Now listen good. This is what Rav Yaakov Galinsky says. He says, every one of us is signing in our certificate how much Hashem is going to pay us for learning Torah. We decide. How can we decide how much the reward is going to be? Imagine a boy comes to his father. He says, Father, I want to get a bike. So the father said to him, which one you want? So you decide. So he said, $1,000 bike. And the father said, okay, you decide. It's yours. That's a very nice thing. Usually, he gets according to what he deserves. You're a good boy, you get. You're not a good boy, take a $40 bike and be happy. Even this you don't deserve, right? That's usually how it works. So what happened here? A person sits and learns Torah. Someone walks into the yeshiva and say, I'm looking for a worker, construction job. Anyone here needs parnasa? So somebody asked him, how much an hour? He said, $10 an hour. So thinking, yeah, he said, 10 hours is not enough. Better I stay to learn. He said, okay, I'll give you 15. Come, get dressed and let's go. 15, how many hours a day? 10, okay, I'm coming. This person just signed on his certificate that every hour Torah learned in his life is worth $15. That's it. And he won't get any a penny more than that. Now Hashem takes the financial value and translates it into spiritual value in the eternal world. Only he knows how to evaluate. We do not know. But it goes together. All the mitzvot is connects with money and work and efforts. Hashem knows how to translate it. And his friend also needs money. He said, I'm not going for 15. He said, okay, I'll give you, don't tell him, I'll give you 25. Come. No. 30. No. 50. I need another worker. Come. No. You give me an hour, I come. 100, I come. So this guy's for 100, so his hour of Torah worth 100. If a person say to this contractor, you give me $1,000,000, I don't come. I'm now learning Torah. Then every hour of Torah I learn, he will get an eternal reward. Not 15, not 100, not 1,000, not 1,000,000, not 1,000,000,000. Eternal reward multiplied by how many hours he learned Torah. Two people learn the same. One got peanuts, one got eternal reward. Isn't it a shame? And it's all because of one reason, stupidity. Or maybe a better, nice word, ignorance. He never knew. He doesn't appreciate the Torah because he never learned the value of the Torah. If the person knows the value of the Torah, he would let himself do such thing? Give up the Torah for an hour, $15, $30, $100? So this is it. So everything that a person does in his life that take him away from his learning, it's a punishment. You should know that. If a person sits and learns, every job offer you got that made you in the end not learn because of that, or every problem you have with your car, you have to spend time by the mechanic or by the doctor, don't just take it as coincidence. If Hashem was 100% happy from your Torah, he would not send you to spend hours by the mechanic all week. The fact that he's sending you over there when you want to learn Torah, that means that's like telling you, you better improve your Torah learning and be more serious and come on time and put more effort and stop talking nonsense in the middle of the learning. Then I will evaluate your Torah accordingly and I won't send you all the problems. We had one guy in our yeshiva, Eliyahu Buchbut his name. Now he's in Israel in Beit Shemesh. He's a serious learning. He came, Baal Tshuva, learned Torah very serious. And mamash, I could almost say that he's addicted to the Torah. That's how he was. Learning, break time, no breaks for him. He had a tiny car. You should see the car. As soon as you see the car, you don't take it from the junkyard for free, this car. I say, by the time I get home, probably going to need a tow truck. Better not to take a risk. But for the few years he was in yeshiva, this car served him like a Mercedes. Not one time he had to go to mechanic. The car is driving and driving and driving and driving. One day he made Aliyah to Eretz Israel. So he sold the car to another guy in yeshiva. That guy wasn't learning serious like him. He's in, he's out, he's on the phone rings, he runs out, coffee, tea, that. Speaking in the middle of the learning. As soon as he got the car, every week he's by the garage. Every week. All the years that the car never had a problem, this guy got everything. So this guy thinking, wow, this guy sold me a bad car. No, he sold you a perfectly running car. But your sins or whatever you do made you now run to the mechanic every day. What do you think? Because melechet tzadikim naaset bidei acherim. When you are righteous, all your needs are done by people who would serve you. You know, one time the rabbi gave a drasha in a yeshiva, and he said, today we're going to speak about confidence. Confidence in God, in Parnasa. So I decide that we'll do an experiment. Tomorrow morning, we all go to the forest, and we learn all day Gemara in the forest, and Bezrat Hashem, we will see how Hashem will find a way to feed us in the forest. So they went to the forest. Breakfast did not come. Lunch did not come. Around 2 o'clock, two of the students say, well, maybe this rabbi becoming a senile. Let's go to the yeshiva, eat, because if we stay here, we'll starve by the evening. So they ran quickly to the yeshiva. They ate very good. So they came about to go back to the learning. So one guy says, so it's not fair. All our friends are embarrassed to leave. They're learning there, and they're probably very hungry. Let's take bowl, bread, something, and we bring it to them. So he writes, thank you very much for thinking. So they pick up the big bowls. They come, bread, drinks. They run. They come behind. They put it by the bushes over there. And they come, they sit. After 5 minutes, one of them says, Rabbi, you're right. Look, Hashem sent us the food all the way to here. Wow, hot soup, this, meat. So the rabbi, he saw that, he started to dance. Shtabach Shemo, I knew you'll never let us down. So the rabbi is dancing, and they're all laughing. You know, like. Everyone ate. The rabbi said, ah, Shtabach Shemo, you always perform, Baruch Hashem. Friday, he gives the drasha for Shabbat, before they go away for Shabbat. So he says in the middle of the drasha, there are two genius guys here that they think that I am the fool. He said, but they do not know that when I told the yeshiva that we're going to go and learn in the forest, Hashem will provide for us one way or the other. They do not know that Hashem used both of them for not having confidence in him to be our servants. He sent them to bring us the food, you understand? This is what happened. When you do what Hashem wants, your enemy becomes your servant. You know how many times someone who comes to hurt you in the end does the best service for you? How many times in life? Thousands of times. Say Lashon Hara against you, ruin your shidduch. 2 years later, you find out the girl had chas v'shalom, a bad sickness and died, or the other way around. So really, he came to ruin your life, he saved your life. Oh, in Parnasa, in all kinds of things. I'll tell you a story, I'll knock you down on the floor now. One guy went to India. One guy from Yeshiva went to India. And, you know, he wanted to see certain things in India. So he came to a motel in India, and he found a suitcase with $50,000. The previous tenant in a hotel left a suitcase in a closet. He saw $50,000, he had the belt, you know. He took quickly all the $100 bill, he stuck it in his belt, on his socks, everywhere, jackets. So now he has $50,000, he picked up his stuff, let me run quickly, I check out before he's going to come. It's one of these Indian goyim, let me get away with the money. So he's about to leave, police showed up. Where are you going? Hey, stay right here. Say, well, what's going on? He said, this person claimed he lost $50,000 here. He left the money here. So he said to him, I never saw anything. So he said to him, what do you mean you didn't see him? Only a few hours I was here. You're the first tenant who came here. So who took it? So what are you blaming me? Maybe the cleaning lady took it. What do I know? Let me go now. He said, no, police say we have to search on you. We have probable cause. We have to search on you. So they search on him. You see tons of money. So he said to him, what is the problem? Now, this guy, okay, now I remember the story better. It wasn't in India. It was in a different country, and he went to collect tzedakah. And he went to collect tzedakah, and he found $50,000 in a hotel, in a motel. So now, the police found the $50,000 on him. He had another $1,000 of his own. So the police say to him, listen, this is his money. We're going to have to arrest you for lying to us. So he said to them, what are you talking about? I'm a diamond dealer, and I came here to do business, so I have to carry a lot of cash on me. Ma, well, how are you going to buy diamonds? You need at least $50,000 cash. So they say to him, can you tell us a telephone number to verify it? Now, what telephone number he can give? He's avrech in yeshiva. He learns in yeshiva. He's a singer. He's not avrech. He's not married. He's learning in yeshiva. So he say, wow, I'm now in deep problem now. Let me give them the telephone number of the yeshiva in Israel. And Hashem, please help me that, you know, the right person would pick up the phone and would know what to say. Because otherwise I'm going to lose all this money. So what happened? He has one enemy in yeshiva who is jealous with him and hates him and speaks lashon hara against him all the time. From all the 50 guys in yeshiva, who came to pick up the phone? His biggest enemy. So his biggest enemy picked up the phone and he hears someone speaking in English. Excuse me, we are trying to find out about Moshe Cohen. He's claiming, you know, the other guy doesn't understand English. I heard name Moshe Cohen, his biggest enemy. So he thought he went to America to collect charity. And this is probably one of the rich people who wants to check if he's really in this yeshiva, no? So he said to him, don't believe him. He's a liar. He's a rich guy. He doesn't need charity. He's a very rich guy. You know, he has money. He makes himself look poor, but he's really rich. Say, so, okay, thank you, sir. Thank you. No problem. Thank you. He says, sir, we're very sorry. We verified. You know, you're a wealthy guy. Fine, you can go. They left him alone. They don't have proof. So the Gemara asks a question. The Gemara asks an interesting question. Mipnei ma nitna Torah lebnei Israel, le'am Israel. Why the Torah was given to the Jewish nation from all the nations? Why? Biglal shehem azim. Because they are, the right word is probably arrogant. Stubborn, arguing, fighting, stubborn, don't take things easy. Everything is a war. Eat kosher. Who said it's not kosher? You tell me what's kosher, what's, for me this is kosher. Everything become a debate. Everything be debate. So what happened? Hashem said, once they learn Torah, it would soften them and make them righteous. And we see today, it's very interesting. People that don't learn Torah can reach a level of monsters. I find some people like this. But people who were supposed to be monsters, when they learned Torah for X amount of months, they became different people. Took away all the arrogance, all the anger, and they became different people. And sometimes a person can learn Torah for X amount of years and then leave the Torah and go into business, and he becomes monster again. What you learn helps. As far as knowledge, but to soften you, to make you a better character, only while you're learning. As long as you're learning, it's working. When you're not learning, you're falling. You're falling down in your spirituality and in your traits and your personality. So Hashem say, they'll be busy learning Torah and Musar and ethics, it will make them good characters. If not, Hashem Yirachem. So you look at the Jews today in the world. You either become Chacham Ovadia Yosef or you become Bernie Madoff. There's really not that much in between. Either you're a good person who loves the Torah and appreciates the Torah and do what the Torah say, or you sell stolen credit cards or all kinds of tricks like this. Unfortunately. So that's why the nature, the Gemara say, that's what's beautiful about our Torah, that it's 100% objective. He said all the truth, even when it's not so pleasant to hear. Believe me, the rabbis could have erased that from their memory. Why did they have to write in the Gemara that Hashem gave us the Torah? Because we are again. Why did he have to say it? He could have not. Why do we have to speak Lashon Hara about ourselves? We don't have to write it. Why? That the whole world would see that this is what the Gemara say? Well, let's erase it and not write it down. But we say the good, we also say the bad. But it's not necessarily bad. That's the whole point. That the power of the Torah can take an arrogant person and make him holy and great. This is the power of the Torah. And you see right away, look at the kids. Kids who go to good yeshivot and kids who go to public school. Right away, see the difference. Sometimes I go to places to give lecture. The owner of the house. I see right away, you look at these kids, you see if they go to yeshiva or to public school. Even without their yarmulke and tzitzit. By the way they behave in the house. You see how they behave, and you see how other places you go, how the kids behave, how they talk, how they dress, how they in the neighborhood, What are they doing? What are these? All kinds of things that they already know about. You get very scared. Without Torah, life could be very dangerous. Time is running out. And, you know, the Gemara says, Gadol Talmud Torah, Shemevi Lide Maaseh. The learning of the Torah, it's very great. Why? Because it brings a person into action, to better actions. So what are we learning here? That if a person learns Torah and it does not bring him to a better actions, he may not have a share to the world to come. Even though every Jew is born with a share to the world to come, some sins that we can do, God forbid, can make us lose it. But why a person that learns Torah and it won't make him a tzaddik, he would not become righteous, why there is no guarantee that he has his share to the world to come? Why? He learned Torah after all. It's a very big mitzvah. So where do we learn it? We learn it in a very interesting way. This is what it says. It says like this. We learned it from the story of Rabbi Yossi Bar Kisma and Rabbi Hanina Ben Tardion. What's the story? Rabbi Yossi Bar Kisma was a holy Tana 2,000 years ago, and he became sick. He was laying in his bed, and another huge Tana, Rabbi Hanina Ben Tardion, came to visit him in his bed. This was in a time that the Romans were making us very hard time. You're not allowed to learn Torah, and definitely not allowed to teach Torah. If they catch you teaching Torah in public, they execute you and the people right away. So it was mamash a life risk to learn Torah. Couldn't do lectures. They go around like a police, the Romans in Israel, everyone who they find talking about Torah, they kill him. So Rabbi Yossi Bar Kisma, not only he teach Torah, he gathers everyone on the street, and he teach them the Torah, and any second one of the Romans can come and right away and catch him over there, and that's going to be a disaster. So when he came, this was Rabbi Hanina. Rabbi Hanina is teaching Torah. So he comes to Rabbi Yossi to visit him. So Rabbi Yossi say to him, instead of saying to him, thank you for coming to visit me, he say to him, tell me, I want to ask you a question. Why do you play with fire with these Romans and you teach Torah in public? Don't you know that you have to be afraid of them because if they catch you, they'll kill you and it's going to be a disaster, a tragedy? So he told him, Hashem Ya'azor, Min HaShamayim Yirachamu, Hashem will have mercy on us. So he said to him, I'm giving you words of wisdom, a wise advice, and this is what you're answering me? That Hashem will have mercy on us? I'm wondering if your end would not be that the Romans will catch you and take the Torah and wrap you with the Torah and burn you together with the Torah. I wonder. And that's how he died. That was his end. But after he told this to Rabbi Hanina, Rabbi Hanina told him, Rabbi Hanina is one of the Asara Aruge Malchut, that we cry on Tisha B'Av, he's one of the 10. So Rabbi Hanina told him, tell me, at least will I have a share to the world to come? So he asked him, did you do any act of mitzvah? Maaseh baliyatcha, you did something? Tell me what you did, so I'll tell you. He said, yes. One time I went, I had money for Purim that I wanted to give to the poor people, and I had different money, and it got mixed in my pocket by mistake. So I didn't know how much I have to give to the poor people, so I took all my money, and the tzedakah money that got mixed, and I gave everything from the doubt. I didn't want to owe them a penny, so I took everything and I gave it to the poor people. So he said to him, yes, you'll have a share to the world to come. This Gemara is incredible, incredible, if you understand what's happening here. Incredible. Why it's incredible? The Gemara just say, he was risking his life to teach Torah that the Jews would not forget to become religious. Is there any bigger mitzvah than teaching Jews, especially in a time of danger and risking your life for it? There's no mitzvah come near this. But besides that, listen good. After all that, he died on Kiddush Hashem. So someone who was not even righteous, but gave his life for Kiddush Hashem, that alone should give him a share to the world to come. So what is he asking him? Did you do any act of mitzvah? You should have told him, what do you mean mitzvah? Every day I teach Torah. He didn't know he's going to die yet, so he couldn't use it as a claim. So from here we learn that you learn Torah or even teach Torah is very nice. But you also have to behave according to the Torah. If the Torah says to give tzedakah, you still have to give tzedakah even you learn Torah all day. If the Torah says to do chesed, you have to do chesed. If the Torah says to eat matzah, you must eat matzah. To put tefillin, there's no connection. Yes, you learn Torah, you're going to get your reward. But you have to do the mitzvot of the Torah, not only to learn them. Therefore, if you learn, and it doesn't bring you into action, something is not right in your learning also. Cannot be that you learn for the sake of heaven and you stay the same monster that you are. Cannot be. And if this is the case, for sure, you're not learning in a right way. You're learning for ego, for pride, for money, for business, for shiduch. You know how many guys go to good yeshivot just for shiduch? If you tell them now when they're 18, you don't have to go to Lakewood, don't worry. Your shiduch is guaranteed. Here, she's waiting for you. Many of them won't go. They only go because they know I'm going to learn 2-3 years, I'm going to come up with a great shiduch. Get good shiduchim over there. It's good reputation, good yeshiva. Thousands of people learn Torah. Not everyone equal. Some are very holy and learn very serious. Some less. Just like everywhere else. So the ones who are less benefit from the reputation of the yeshiva. You know, if you went to Harvard in business, you get right away special respect. Even you were the biggest loser in Harvard. Just you come, you use this name, right away they open the door for you. Come, there's 5 interviews waiting for you. That's how it works, this bluff of the United States and the world. So, you know, it's one yeshiva guy needed money right away to marry his daughter. How much he need? $10,000 to make a very simple wedding. So he came to New York and he went to the Satmar Rebbe. This guy Hasid. So he went to the Satmar Rabbi. He came to the Satmar Rabbi, told him, listen, I don't have money. How am I going to marry my daughter? I learned Torah all day. So the Satmar Rebbe had money that people donate. So he went to his safe and he got $9,999. And he said to him, listen, after searching in all my safes and drawers and my pocket and everything, I came out with $9,999. Please forgive me. I'm short by a dollar, but I'm sure you're going to find it somewhere else. So this guy kissed his hand. Thank you, Rabbi. Thank you. You made my day. Wow, Baruch Hashem. So he took the money and left. The Shamash, the helper of the Rabbi, said, oh, Rabbi, if you didn't have another dollar, you ask me, I'll give you a dollar. I'm sure you have much more in a safe. He said, of course I have. So why you gave him $9,999? He said, I'll tell you why. The nature of a person is that if I would give him the entire $10,000, all his life he would suffer. I should have asked for more. I see how quick he gave me the $10,000. What a fool. I would say 30, you'll get me the 30. But now when he told you I collected everything and I gave you 9999, oh, I know how much to ask. I aimed exactly to his soul, to his full amount of money. You see what a clever idea. One person came to Rav Shach. He said, Rabbi, I opened a new yeshiva. And the old Rosh Yeshiva is very upset with me. Tell people not to come to learn by me, not to pray by me. What is it his business? I'm in the other side of town. I'm not taking away his people. What's the problem? There's going to be another place of Torah. Please talk to him. You're the biggest rabbi in Bnei Brak. Talk to him. Tell him to leave me alone. So Rav Shach told him, wait 5 minutes. He went to his safe. He got a bunch of money, $5,000 cash. Came to him and said, here, this is for you. Have a nice day. So this person took the money, thank you, Rabbi, and left. So there was another rabbi sitting there. He said, Rabbi, I don't understand what happened here. He came to tell you about this rabbi that's running after him and fighting against him and ruining his reputation. They wanted you to speak to the rabbi. Why didn't you go and bring $5,000 and give it to him? He said to him, when you work with the public, you have to know what they really want to say, not what they say, what's really in their mind. You really care, you think he cared, the rabbi said that. He want money. The other rabbi make him right now not collect. Because everyone wants to give him. Say, see, he went, he opened another yeshiva. He says, I gave him money. Right away, the problem solved. This is what he really wanted. Sometimes people come, they talk to you half an hour, they're afraid to get to the point. If you're not clever enough, You wait, when you wonder, what's this person want from me? How many minutes it's talking and talking? You have to help him out to get to the point. You got to know and say, okay, I understand the problem. You want to talk about this and this and that. That's okay. And you solve the problem in 5 minutes. But if you let him talk and talk, in the end, sometimes he leaves. And the next day call, there's one more thing I have to talk to you. Can we make another appointment? The conclusion, of all what we say tonight, just before we're approaching Shavuot holiday, that every one of us should remember, the night of Shavuot is a holy night. And when you come to learn in a shul all night, not only you learn and bring cakes and fruits and cookies and that and coffee, half of the time is busy drinking and eating. The other half, someone gives him massage, or he gives someone massage. And then after that, he goes to sleep in the back for 2 hours. By the end of the night, he will be better off sleep in bed. What's this picnic in the middle of the night in the shul? You either come to learn. So if you have problems learning at night, staying up, sleep during the day. Chacham enaf berosho. Someone clever predict what's going to be. So you rest in the afternoon. Like this, you can stay. Women don't have to stay all night. They want, of course, they welcome, but they don't have to. But man has to learn Torah. It's his obligation. So we learn Torah all night, and we daven early, and this is what we, this is the custom in most of the places. The Sfaradim has a special tikkun. The Ari HaKadosh made a special tikkun, a little bit from each part of the Torah. It's built that you touch every part of Judaism of the Torah. The Ashkenazim don't go like the Ari, most of them. So they learn Gemara, they learn other things. They have Shiur, the Rosh Yeshiva gives Shiur, whatever the case is. One way or the other, it's very important. It's Torah, this is Torah, and this is Torah. But Sfaradim has to go by their custom. It's true, if a Sfaradi learns Gemara, it's also good. He learns any Torah. But if they designed it in such a way, and even the biggest rabbis in the last 500 years were reading the Tikkun, they also love to learn Gemara and things in a higher level. But they were reading the Tikkun, the biggest tzaddikim. Why they read it? They ask Rav Ben Zion Abba Shaul, we want to learn something else. We'll do a shiur, 3-4 hours, pilpul in a Gemara. Well, what do we need to read the Tikkun? He said, no, if Ari made the Tikkun, there's reasons for the Tikkun. So dafka, the Tikkun is better. By the Ashkenazim, they didn't have the Tikkun. Even Ashkenazi who does the Tikkun is better for him also. Because the Ari is not only for Sfaradim, it's for all the Jewish nation. It's just that the custom that he went to Sfaradi countries more than Ashkenazi countries. Today, we have a very common problem in our world. The Jewish nation is split to two different sides, the Sfaradi and the Ashkenazi part. Why? I'll tell you something. Besides the food and the customs and the names, which is different, there is today something that when you ask a Sfaradi to do something that one of the Ashkenazi big rabbis say, he say, well, my rabbi is the Sfaradi rabbi. I go by him. I don't go by him. Making like it looks like two Torahs, the Torah for them, the Torah for us. It doesn't matter if the rabbi who told it to you is Sfaradi or Ashkenazi. You only have to worry if he's big in the Torah or no. If he's big in the Torah, you have to listen to everything he say. If he's not big in the Torah, you're not obligated to listen to him. But by no means, there's no difference whatsoever where this rabbi is from, Morocco, Tunisia, or Poland. There's no, what's the connection? The Torah is the same Torah. If he tells you what he thinks the Torah means, this is what you have to do. It doesn't matter where he's from. Today, according to this, this is what we do. According to this, this is what we do. So now remember, I'm not talking custom. Customs are different. But custom is not as important as what the Torah says. It's custom. But the mitzvah from the Oraita is much bigger. So therefore, when there is an argument between a Sfaradi rabbi to an Ashkenazi rabbi, if you're allowed to do something on Shabbat, and the Ashkenazi rabbi say, no, it's Chilul Shabbat, and the Sfaradi disagree, who do you have to do like as a Sfaradi? You Sfaradi. Who do you have to do like? Like the Sfaradi who allows it, or like the Ashkenazi who say it's Chilul Shabbat? You're willing to take a risk? This big Talmid Chacham say to you it's Chilul Shabbat. You're not afraid? How are you going to sleep at night? What happened if he's right in the argument? We don't know. 50% chance that he's right, no? It's two big, two Gdolei Torah arguing. One say you allow this on Shabbat, one says you're not allowed. What do you care who said what? Whether it's the Sfaradi allow it or whether this, the Ashkenaz allow it, you have to go like the strict one. Why? It's Isur d'Oraita, it's a sin from the Torah. If it's a mitzvah from the Rabbanan, a rabbinical law, you can go like the lenient one. And again, it doesn't matter, Sfaradi, Ashkenazi. This is a very big mistake today. Everyone, no, we the Ashkenazim do this. We the Sfaradim do this. Beloni, we have to do what the rabbis agreed to do, whether they're here, whether they're there. However, if you do not know to learn, you do not know how to learn, and you don't know anything, unfortunately, then you have to dedicate yourself one rabbi and you go like everything like him. Because you don't know. You don't want to learn and you pay the price. But if you know how to learn, everything in the Torah, you hear all opinions and you know who to do like. If you don't know how to learn, then you have to take one rabbi and everything you ask him. Why? Because you do not know how to read. You don't know how to understand. So every little thing, you have to, rabbi, I have to ask you, how many times you do Netilat Yadayim? 3 or 4? You have to ask, because you cannot read on your own. Rabbi, this one say aloud, this one doesn't say aloud. What should I do? You have to ask. But if you knows how to learn Torah, you know the rule. If it's a mitzvah from the Torah, and some say you're allowed, some say you're not allowed, you have to not take a risk. Why? Mechalel Shabbat is a very big sin. It's worse than a murder. You should remember this. In the Ten Commandments, to be Mechalel Shabbat is a bigger punishment than to murder a person. If someone will come to you and say, take this baby, drown him in a bath, I'll give you $100,000 cash right now. Take this baby, drown him. Would you do it? Of course not. If you light fire or electric light bulbs on Shabbat or things like this or start the car, it's worse than murdering this baby. It's a bigger sin in the Torah and people do not know it. And the punishment for that is bigger. Killing the baby, you get executed by a sword. Starting your car, you get executed by stoning and have no share to the world to come. The soul gets cut out of God's eternal life. So what's bigger punishment? Of course, Mechalel Shabbat. But why people don't look at that like that? And now when I say it, they think I'm crazy. Why? Because when they went to elementary school or high school or whatever, to a secular school, all they heard about, be careful not to be a murderer. So that part they got. But nobody ever told him that to be Mechalel Shabbat is worse. Nobody. In secular school, nobody talks about Shabbat because the teacher comes to school sometimes on Shabbat with a car. So how she's going to tell you not to drive on Shabbat? They themselves make this sin. So what's going on? Since you grew up and nobody talked about Shabbat and everyone around already does it, it became a habit. Everyone does it. I'm also doing it. But it doesn't change your verdict. That's the problem. You won't be able to say to Hashem, everyone did it, so I also did it. No. If you drive on a highway 80 miles an hour and they caught you, and you said to the policeman, come on, be honest. You saw everyone was driving 80. Why me? So that's it, my buddy. Today it's you, tomorrow it's someone else. You come to the judge, you say to them, but everyone was driving 80. The judge said, for your chutzpah, add another $100 fine. What are you telling me? You use it as an excuse why you violate the law? So if a person comes to Hashem and says, Hashem, everyone was Mechalel Shabbat. What do you want from me? Hashem says, yeah, it's very sad that everyone is Mechalel Shabbat. But now we're dealing with you. You understand? People don't understand certain things in the Torah, and they make big mistakes in their life, and then they face this mistake. Our job, those who know, to prevent them from doing this mistake. Bezrat Hashem, I brought you here 3 CDs. You can take, don't save, take a lot. Give it to every secular person you know. Your friends, cousins, neighbors, children, parents, whatever there is, you can take 5, you can take 10, you can take 50. Whatever you take, but make sure you give it out. Don't leave it on your shelf. It costs me $1 each. Don't take 50 and leave 45 on the shelf for 5 years. That's already mamash burning tzedakah money. Take and give. Hand to people. Hand to people. You have a business. You have a place that secular people come. Store, restaurant, whatever it is. You want to put over there? No problem. People come, they take. It's also very good. Yeah, but, and you have a big mitzvah in it. Once you pick it up, he listens to it, becomes Shomer Shabbat, it counts, you made him religious. Could it be a better investment? Every time you keep Shabbat, it counts you did. Every time he gives tzedakah, it counts you did. Every time he ate kosher, it counts you did. Every time he was nice to his wife, because Hashem said to be nice, You count like you did. So, and then one day you have children and grandchildren, and then 500 years of mitzvot, everything goes to your account. Why? That you put it in a restaurant or in a store, or you give it up in your work. And we'll finish with one last story. One guy went to work, and he saw that the girl over there comes very not modest. So he asked her, listen, you know, I'm a Baal Tshuva, I'm religious. Why don't you dress properly? She said to him, you don't tell me how to behave. It's a free country. We are in a democracy. Israel is a democracy. It's not Iran. That's how they answer. Don't force your religion on me. So every day, maybe now he has to sit in front of her. They're in a room together. She's here and he's facing her at the desk. That's how it is. And he said to himself, maybe I better quit my job. But then he's thinking, my wife, my children, what am I going to do? Find a job, it's going to take me months. He went to his rabbi. He said, Rabbi, what should I do? Should I quit the job and hope that I find a job quickly, that I don't start going into debt? Or I should stay there and try to close my eyes as much as I can, even though it's impossible because you cannot work. So the rabbi said to him, listen, tomorrow, listen good. Tomorrow, on the way to work, stop by the gas station. When you fill up gas in a pump, take a very old suit of yours, rip suit that you don't use, and put gasoline all over the suit. Make sure that you smell very good. And go to work. And say, Rabbi, when you enter the room, she would smell this gasoline, she'll go crazy. So she tells you, what's happened to you? You say, that's my new perfume. From now on, every day I come like this. So she's going to tell you, crazy, you cannot do it. People suffering. You tell her, it's a free country, it's democracy. That's what he did. 5 minutes later, she said, you want me to go change now? Or you can wait until tomorrow. You understand? That's called betachbulot ha'aseh lecha milchama. When you go to war, you gotta plan your strategy, you know? If you're not, then you get stuck, not ready. You do it clever way. You don't have to fight with her, cursing, screaming. You do something clever. She has no choice. You play with me games, I'll play with you games, and we even. The next day, she came like a rabbit said, and he gave up his perfume. Thank you very much for coming. Hope to see you soon. Thank you very much.